sex, love, and all that relates to it. Sex, love, and awareness. In the past, there has been a few questions, and I will speak on that. Sex is natural, is spontaneous, and very source of all life. There are things and states beyond it. Beautiful spaces beyond it too are there. It brings joy and misery too. Both joy and misery is mixed with sex, because sex is a mixture of heaven and earth, body and soul. It brings both. It gives you wings one moment and cuts off your wings the very next moment. One moment it brings ecstasy, next moment you have fallen into a deep agony. One moment you are on the sunlit peak, and the next moment you are groaning in a dark valley. Sex is both. Going beyond this is the ultimate flowering of your being. Sex is not an end in itself. It is the beginning of the journey, of which the ultimate flowering is the culmination. To progress, more steps are needed. One in whom sex is transformed and has attained the ultimate neither encourages sex nor does he condemn it. He has simply tried to make sense and give meaning to it. And a process which is basically directed towards finding a meaning is essentially a spiritual one. Generally, sex is either condemned or taken for granted. There is hardly any conscious effort to know what it means. What is this universal creative energy? Spirituality is all about the search for the meaning of that which is, why it is, and why it is the way it is. And in that search for the meaning, one automatically sees that which is meaningless, and seeing the meaninglessness, one intelligently drops all that is meaningless. On one hand, we are culturally blind and we cannot see what sex is. And on the other hand, we are meaning blind, that we do not know what this life energy means. I am giving a kind of intelligence to know what sex is all about and how to deal with this energy spiritually. Sufis rarely initiate a person who is married. Marriage helps to sublimate the volatile nature of this energy, and if one has understood the existential energy, the transformation becomes possible. I will emphasize on how does the thought process comes into it, how we go on nourishing and nurturing various thoughts. And that creates a problem, because thought is energy, and energy cannot be destroyed. So we have to be very careful what kind of thoughts arise in human mind when we encounter a particular situation. We are going on the street, we see a person, a thought comes to our mind, and we do not have awareness at that moment to dissolve that thought. That thought remains within us, and it can manifest in many forms. If a thought comes in you against an enlightened one, then through his awakening, the enlightened one can remove that thought. But normally when we encounter, we are unconscious people. We are not aware why this particular thought is arising in us. A simple example is, we are all have jobs to do. We are holding important positions. you are working on a project, maybe working on a file, and the day comes to an end, you are tired, you leave that file unfinished for the next day. You come home, you engage in other activities, and maybe it is a long weekend. When you return to the office, it becomes very difficult to start where you have left. You will take time to recapitulate what you have left before the holidays began. This gap always exists when we leave something incomplete. This is what has happened. We had just entered into a relationship. We did not allow it to fruition. Existence does not want anything to be left incomplete. You have entered into a relationship. Allow it to attain to fruition. And only when it attains fruition, it drops. It becomes meaningless. You look at a tree that bears fruits. First flower comes. Flower is converted into a fruit. In the beginning, the fruit is green. Then slowly and slowly the fruit ripes. And when it gets ripe, its process is complete. Now it will drop automatically. When we leave something incomplete, it hangs around our consciousness. When you leave that file incomplete, that work, maybe the thought hangs around your consciousness when you are holidaying, your family wants an outing, over the weekend you went for outing, but that thought remains in your mind. This we need to understand. And then we have to understand what is the nature of sex. Sex, it has a biological aspect and psychological aspect. Sex has nothing to do with biological age. Sex indeed is a part of human psychology. Man has not yet matured psychologically that biological and mental age becomes same. We grow biologically, but psychologically we do not grow. As a result, the average mental age of a person, psychology says it is 12 years. We have never discovered the cause of this. You can be 600 or of any other age, it will still be there. The sex will always be there. It has nothing to do with age. Certainly, it has to do with awareness. Remember, just by growing old, you never grow up. You may be 60 years old biologically, but you may be just near about 12, 13, or at the most 14 psychologically. This is the cause of hang-ups. A person who is psychologically 14 is bound to be haunted by sex. And people are stuck at somewhere near about 13, 14 years of age psychologically. Therefore, they remain sexually haunted lifelong. It is said that the average mental age of humanity is 12. It is unbelievable that people get stuck so early. What happens and why at just near about 12, 13 or 14 we get stuck and do not grow? That is the time when sex ripens in you. But society never wants you to go beyond that point. Every society wants you to remain sexually starved and dwarf. A sexually starved person is very useful for society. Such a starved person can be channelized in any direction very easily because he is boiling within. You look at the terrorist activities, people who enter into terrorism or those kind of activities, they are brainwashed from the early age and they are all of a very young age. You can make him run after money, then money will be his sex, and then his whole life, sexual energy which is stopped will move towards money. Then money will be his beloved, his God, and for his whole life he will run after the money. And naturally sex will haunt him because money cannot satisfy the sexual needs. You can gather as much money as you aspire, but how can it satisfy your basic urge? The society has diverted your urge by giving you a toy. And that is how we start from the very beginning. Child is crying. He wants milk, but he is given a pacifier. And the poor child starts sucking the pacifier and thinks that it is mother's breast. How mean can we be? This is sheer meaningless. You are being very political with the poor child, diplomatic and cunning. The poor child has no understanding yet to make a distinction between the pacifier and the breast. He has been deceived. Now, if later on the child one day disrespects his mother or hates her, there is no wonder in it. And for that matter, every child does not like something or the other in the parents. When you are growing up as a child, you have no option but to accept it. When you are old, then these things surface. You can go to any psychoanalyst and ask him what is the fundamental problem of every person. And you will be surprised to know that he will not give you some names: neurosis, psychosis, schizophrenia, hysteria, etc. If you ask him what is the fundamental problem of every psychologically disturbed person, he will say mother. But why the mother is the cause? She was the first with whom the child begins interaction. And mother is the one who started deceiving the child. She was the first acquaintance of the child with the world. And he cannot trust anyone now. He cannot even trust his own mother. How can he trust anyone else? And when the child was crying and he wanted to be hugged, he was given a teddy bear. A child needs warmth as much as milk. The warmth of love is deep psychological need of the child. One day I was at the airport and I saw an incident. A woman along with her child was waiting for her husband to arrive. So she was conversing with the child, playing with the child. As soon as, do not know if a husband or whoever it is, but a male person, as soon as the person came, she started giving him hugs and kiss. The poor child was looking at them, and she was not given any attention. All the attention that woman was giving is to that male counterpart. She was not even holding the hand of the girl. She was just following, looking at the face of the two who were looking constantly at one another. This is unconsciousness. how can we understand? We forget the emotions of the others. Now, it is a proven scientifically that if a child is given all nourishment but no warmth of the body, he or she will shrink and ultimately die. Or even if he survives, the child will remain retarded and unhealthy for the rest of his life. Something will be missing in him. He not only needs mother's milk, instead he needs the warmth of the mother's bosom and mother's body as well. That warmth is now understood to be absolutely fundamental necessity. But when the child is crying, he cannot say, "Mom, I want to be hugged," because he has no language as yet. But his crying indicates the need for hugs and kisses, caressing, and ultimately closeness to the mother. And he is given a teddy bear, or he is given some toy to be engaged in. He is being deceived from the very beginning. He wants something, but he gets something else. This is how we go on distorting the children. By the time a child reaches sexual maturity, we start giving him ambitions. We start telling him, come first in the university, come first in the school. Wherever you are, whatever you are doing, you have to be the first. We create a great desire in his mind to be first everywhere he is. This is the way of giving a new direction to sexual energy. The society is trying to divert his natural energies. We start telling him, unless you have a big car, big house, and much money in the bank, you are a failure. He starts running after big things. He may not need a big house. In fact, a smaller house may be far more beautiful because it can be kept cleaner easily. And his needs are not that much that he should have a big house of many, many rooms. But the idea has been implanted in his mind, unless you have a big house, very imposing, you are a failure. Now the big house becomes a symbol of fulfillment and prestige. Money in the bank becomes a symbol of fulfillment. However, these are only empty symbols. Deep down he remains unfulfilled. There is constant deep hankering. The deep down unconsciousness is continuously telling him to be natural and let his natural energies flow in a natural and spontaneous way. Tantra teaches you how to allow the energies to move naturally and spontaneously. Now, how does it relate to thoughts? I mentioned to you the thought is energy and it cannot be destroyed in any way. You are walking on the street, all of a sudden you spot a person, a thought comes to your mind that I wish I can give this person a hug. He or she looks very beautiful and she has a wow factor. But you remember, this is not possible. You nourish that thought. That thought remains in your psyche, and when you are entering into relationship, your own relationship, it becomes a hindrance. And sometimes different kind of thoughts arise in our minds. I heard there was one of our friend was a very good looking, attractive, a young female. She happens to go to a place in India. There he met a person who was South Indian of a dark complexion. He liked that person very much and got very much attracted in the first instance. But his upbringing will not tell him straight away anything. So he said, "I wish I was your child. I was your son." No offense is there. But deep down, you think why the person wants to be the son of a young, beautiful female being. Because when you are establishing a relationship at that level, it is not offense. Between two grown-up people, the mother and the son, father and the daughter, relation cannot be established at the physical plane. There remains a conflict at the psychological as well as the physical plane. We have to have harmony or consistency at the two planes. Now, Hindu scripture speaks of one incident. There was a demon king called Bali. His atrocities was increasing and increased to that extent that an incarnation was necessary. Vishnu assumed the form of a midget. He was born as a midget. And the king was performing a yajna. Whenever a yagya or a sacrificial, like for instance, as a Muslim we observe Ramzan. During this period we give charities. And according to our capacity we give charities. And you do not hesitate in giving charities. So it happened that the king was performing the act like this. And it was said that he was very generous. If anyone asked him anything, he will give him that. So this incarnation, the Vishnu in the form of a midget, appears in the court of the king Bali. She had a daughter, her name was Ratnamala. As soon as she saw the child, she was captivated by the beauty and the presence of the child. A thought came to her mind, "I wish I could breastfeed this child. I wish I could breastfeed this child." The incarnation accepted it and he said, "Let it be so." Then the king asked, "What do you want?" He said, "I am a poor Brahmin. I want only 3 leg space of land." 3 leg space of land? The king laughed. "You could have asked for more." He said, "No, that is enough. I am of a small stature. That is good enough for me." When the king made the promise that he will give that, he assumed his cosmic form and in one he measured the earth, the entire the earthly region, and in the next he covered the entire heavenly region. Now the third step was still to be taken. So he asked, "Where should I put the third step?" The king said, "That you put it on my head, and with that my atrocities will come to an end and I will get salvation." He puts the third step over the head of the king and he dies. Seeing this, what will be the situation of the daughter? One moment she had a thought towards the boy, "I wish I could breastfeed this child." Next moment, when this happened, he put his third step onto the head of her father, she was filled with anger and she wished to kill him. Does it not happen in our day-to-day life? One moment we are filled with love towards a person, next moment we are filled with remorse, anger. Why did I get married to this person? These conflicting thoughts always remain and thoughts cannot be destroyed. If you are awakened, if you are using your awareness, you had asked a question, how one can transform that energy. Thought is energy, sex is energy, everything is energy. How can that be sublimated? You remember, although I am speaking in parts on this and that, a single talk is more than enough to transform your entire life. You remember I spoke on the 11 kalmat of Sufis. I spoke on awareness. I spoke on bringing meditation into each act that you do. Thought is an act. When a thought is coming to your mind, when anger is coming to your mind, if there is awareness, that energy will dissolve the same very moment. According to this spiritual, the Sufi commandment, it is said the 11 kalmats, and I had added one more, nazar var kadam, hosh dardam, khilwat dar anjuman, safar dar watan. Every moment a constant remembrance of that which is, you can use in the form of zikr, you can use in the form of awareness. The purpose of zikr is not zikr. Zikr is simply a container and the content is awareness. If zikr does not bring, or you are carrying the rosary, people are seeing it, but it has not brought any transformation in you. Now, Hindus go in the month of February, there is worship of Shiva. They offer milk, flour and other things. The prayer begins midnight and early in the dawn that comes to an end. As a child, I had been watching that. The Shiva's worship is very simple. A piece of a stone and a Shiva temple is established. But people will not go to the temple in those remote areas where nobody is seeing them. They would prefer to go and stand up in a long queues, waiting for their turn, because there you are being visible to a large audience. Oh, you went for the puja? Yes, yes, I went there. And it was a long queue. I had to wait nearly an hour or two to do my ritualistic worship. Why can't you do in a place that is remote and where nobody sees you? But we are walking with our rosary in our hand, so everybody sees that you are a very religious person, but deep down do not know what is going on. Every breath is a rosary. The zikr has to be on your each incoming and outgoing breath. You can choose a very simple word and constant remembrance of that. It becomes like a watch word, a security in you. Whenever any thought of that nature or anything is trying to enter you, it will immediately caution you, no, this thought you should not entertain. The moment anger is trying to come into you and you say, no, it is not, then maybe one or two times you may have to experiment. Then it happens before the anger could come in, the security guard comes in and tells you, no, you have to use your awareness. You have to understand that anger is not the right way for the spiritualist. This is awareness. Anything that you do, if that can bring awareness into you, whether you are doing zikr, whether you are doing a mantra, whether you are doing a prayer, or whatever you are doing, it must bring results. And awareness is the result. So what happens in that story? The two kind of thoughts arise against a person, and Krishna was an enlightened one. When many years after that, this particular thought remained in the mind of that daughter of the king, Ratnamala. Much later, when Vishnu assumed the form of Krishna, and he was a child, an infant, his uncle, the demon king, sends a demoness. Now Ratnamala had died, was born into a new form as a demoness called Putna, and she comes. So the king sends Putna to kill that child, about whom the forecast was that this child will be destroyer of him. It is said that Putna had the quality that she can smear poison on her breasts, and this poison will not affect her, but she can kill the child by feeding. So she dresses up as one of the milkmaids and goes to the place where Krishna was being brought up, and she takes the child into her lap with an intention of blessing her, and she said that I can bless by giving her my milk. Her intention was when Krishna will drink the milk. Now this is two instincts, diversified instincts are being fulfilled simultaneously. You want to breastfeed me and you want to kill me, two things. So what happens? First of all, she begins to go into the act of breastfeeding the child. But because you have taken a thought against an enlightened one, how to dissolve that thought? In the hands, when you die in the hands of an awakened one, you attain salvation. When you have developed a thought of this kind towards an enlightened one, the fana is bound to happen, because he will allow these thoughts not to remain into you, and once the thoughts are vanished, your progress where you were stuck, that clears up and your journey becomes easier. So while she begins to breastfeed, Krishna held on to her breast as a baby and started squeezing. In that, she flew from there and gone into a lonely place where she assumed her natural form of a demoness, and Krishna squeezed the breast so hard that she died. And then all the parents, the people from the village ran towards and see what had happened. That demoness has carried Krishna. Then they found that she was lying in a lonely place, and Krishna was playing on her breast, staying, smiling. Thoughts are energy and it cannot be destroyed. It is one of the greatest obstructions in the path of spirituality. And awareness, whichever way awareness comes into you, whether in the form of zikr, whether in the form of prayers, Sufis say that you have to tie yourself through prayers. When you begin the prayers at a certain time, like for instance when Muslims are offering prayers of 5 times, 5 is not that you have to do 5 times. It represents that right true 24 hours one has to be prayerful. And when you are prayerful, the love manifests through you. And not only that, you are aware. Love and awareness go together. You will not have ill word towards the other. So it says that there, whenever you are coming out of your house, you look towards your house and say your prayer that let this house be filled with thy light and awareness. Now you are moving towards your vehicle. Let this be filled with thy light and awareness and take me to the destination wherever I have to go during that day, safe and in good health. You reach to the office. As soon as the office becomes visible, instead of having your attention towards something else, you are sending your light. Let this place of my work be filled with thy light and awareness. Then you are returning home, the same process again. And this is how you are trying to bind yourself in a prayerful attitude. Then ultimately it happens that it becomes a part of your being, part of your life. Then you will be prayerful every single moment. Not even a moment is there when you are not prayerful. If offering 5 times of namaz does not bring that to you, that you are not doing the namaz but something else in that name. The very purpose of offering 5 times or 2 times or 3 times, it must fill you with compassion, and that has to act as your watchword, as your security whenever a moment of unconsciousness comes into you. You can use certain words. We are all made of the same stuff that God is. This has to be your experience, not a thought in your mind. If it becomes experience, then you will not get angry. When you commit a mistake, when your left hand pongs the hammer on the thumb of the right hand, do you get angry on the left hand? Why did you hit the right hand? Because the left hand and the right hand are the part of the same organic existence. This you know very well, so you cannot. But when someone else does it, you get angry on the person and say, you can't do it properly. Where was your mind when you was doing that? Did you say the same thing on behalf of the left hand when the left hand hit the right hand? No. That means the two are the part of the same organic existence. But you do not see this between you and the other person. You do not see between you and your spouse, between you and your friend, between you and your co-worker. You do not consider, if the same mistake you would have done it, you say, oh sorry. But if your subordinate or a person in the office does it, what do? You suspend him, you give him a warning for careless work. Why you didn't do it for yourself? because you consider that as the other person, where is your prayer then? That you had been praying 5 times, 6 times, carrying your rosary all around? It is meaningless if the result is not seen into your behavior. And the purpose of everything is to have that experience that we are all made of the same stuff. Buddha, when he became enlightened, the moment he held on to the fruit in his hand, apple, he felt that apple is made up of the same stuff that he is. Apple is being nourished and nurtured by everything in the existence as he was. There is no difference. When Kabir says, for him, he is weaving, illiterate. He cannot even read and write. He used to sing, and his attendants, his followers used to write what he was saying. Everything for him, he was a weaver, the woof and wove was Ram. Ram, and every customer was for him Ram. I went to the market and I met Ram. I went to the market to sell Ram and I met Ram. And Ram bought Ram. The cloth was Ram, the woof and woof was Ram, the thread was Ram, the customer was Ram. In everything he was seeing that spark of divinity. Unless and until this happens, we are in the month of Ramzan, holy month. Let this be your aspiration. By the time this period of the holy month comes to an end, I should attain to that awareness that I can see the same oneness, can experience the same oneness in and around us. When you have, your child makes a mistake, the child becomes afraid that the father or the mother will get angry on me for this thing. It should be, that's okay. I could have committed the same mistake. But make sure when next time you are doing this, let your total attention be there. But if your attention is diverted, then any kind of accident can take place. This is the way you should interact with the people, and you will experience a totally a different kind of joy within you that you have never experienced within. This is bliss. This is the, it is said during the month of Ramadan, when you pray, you get much more times reward than ordinary act. Why? This begins to overflow because every act that we are doing it joyfully. So every day is a Ramzan. Every day is auspicious because sun has risen. There is light. And that light is an embodiment that God has not forgotten his entire creation. He shines equally, provides its light equally to each and every one of you. This is the way we need to understand whatever the aspect may be, sex, love. And when this begins to happen, you are transcending beyond sex. You have used that energy. It has transformed. It has moved from where it was. It is no more rigid. It is no more greed. It is no more anger. Instead, everything has become lovingness. And when lovingness is there, joy is the reward, the bliss, the eternal happiness. Surur is the gift is the reward that you get.